Well, I want to start in a nice, familiar, comfortable place, Brady, which is this series. 1 + 2 + 3 + 4.
Oh, no.
Oh, no. Right, and all the way up to infinity. Because you do you remember what the answer for that was?
Yeah.
Yeah, what was it?
It's a divergent sum.
Yeah, it's minus the 12th, isn't it? Which is totally uncontroversial. Yeah, that's not weird at all. So I'm not actually going to talk about that series, but I want to talk about something that's related to that series. So I want to consider what happens when we take the reciprocal of all these numbers and take the sum of those. So we take 1 + 1/2 + 1/3 + 1/4 + 1/5. What would we get if we added all these numbers together? You can look at this and you might think, even though someone goes, all right, there's no way that's minus the 12th, but surely it'd be infinity. You look at this and you think, well, what is this? I mean, the numbers are it's clearly getting bigger, but the numbers that you're adding are getting smaller and smaller and smaller. So you might think this goes to a finite answer, but actually it doesn't. This is infinite. This is called the harmonic series, and it is infinite. It was first shown to be infinite by a medieval French mathematician, Nicole Lorem. He showed it in quite an elegant way, which we can go through now. He came up with another series in which each element of the other series was less than the ones you've got here, and showed that guy was divergent. The other series that he looked at was the one where you ask, what is the largest power of a half that's less than the number you're interested in? So let me show you, that's probably the easiest way. So one, well, it's less than or equal to, we're interested in. One is already a power of a half, so we'll leave that as one. A half is, of course, a power of a half, so we'll leave that there. A third, well, the largest power of a half, which is less than or equal to a third, is of course a quarter. Quarter, well, we can leave that as a quarter. A fifth, what's the largest power of a half that is less than a fifth? Well, it's an eighth, which is a half cubed, right? For a sixth, it would also be an eighth. For a seventh, it would also be an eighth. For an eighth, it's an eighth. Okay, the next one would actually be a 16th, and you would go on like that, right? So this is his alternative series. And now you look at this series and you see that it actually has some nice structure. So you've got 1 + 1/2, but then this combination here gives you another half. These four here give you another half. There's going to be 8 of these 16ths. They'll give you another half. And what you're doing is just adding a half loads of times. So it's pretty clear that this indeed diverges. And so by comparison, because each element here is larger than the element here, this guy must also diverge as well. So that's the proof that this diverges. Now,
but hang on, but each element of one.
I knew you were going to say that. There's a sort of nice illustrative way to think about this sum and how it diverges. We've got a lazy band here, right? As we call it in Liverpool. I want to describe this. It can tell us something about this sequence, right? So what I want you to imagine is that this lazy band is like a meter in circumference. I know it's not, but imagine it is. And imagine we put an ant on it, and this ant can travel 1 centimeter a second. Okay, now after each second, we're going to stretch the lazy band so that we add another meter to its circumference. Okay, so after the first second, the ant has moved 1 centimeter. We stretch the lazy band by a meter. Okay, after the next second, the ant's moved another centimeter. We stretch the lazy band by another meter, and so on and so on and so on. Okay, the question is, does the ant ever get all the way around the elastic band?
I can't see how it could.
It seems like you couldn't. It couldn't, right? But it can, right? And it's because of this sequence, right? So let's just see why it can, right? So think about what happens in the first second. Think about the percentage of the lazy band that it manages to traverse. Okay. Well, it's traveled. The lazy band is 1 meter round. It travels 1 centimeter. That's 1%, right? In the first second, it travels 1%. What happens in the second second? Well, in the second second, the lazy band is now 2 meters long. It travels another centimeter. So that's 0.5%. In the third second, the lazy band is now 3 meters long. It travels 1 centimeter. That's 1/3% of the total length of the lazy band. And so on, okay? It's the same sequence. But this goes to infinity. It only has to get to 100%, never mind infinity, right? clearly he's going to get all the way around the Lazy band. And actually you can work out how long it takes him, right? It takes him about e to the 100 seconds, which is about 10 to the 50 seconds, which is quite a long time. It's sort of amusing to think what would happen if you started the experiment now and by the time the ant finished it. Well, before he got to the end, the sun would have become a red giant and probably swallowed up the earth.
You're adding 1 meter every second.
Yeah.
And it's only moving 1 centimeter every second. So every second, the finish line is getting further away. Every second.
But what was behind it also gets further away. So it's not just the distance in front of it, but also the distance behind. And you can see what's really important is the percentage that it accumulates. And you can see that it just grows and grows and grows and grows and grows. Eventually it hits 100. But, you know, after e to the 100 seconds, roughly, more or less, it gets there. But yeah, I mean, you know, to be honest, you know, we would have even, by the time you get to the end of this game, the universe has entered a black hole era where all the matter and stars and including our experiments has ended up inside black holes. So this is a gargantuan time. And what that illustrates is really how slowly this series grows. It grows very, very slow. It grows indefinitely, but it does so very slowly. And you can see that by how long it takes the ant to go all the way around. It actually grows logarithmically slowly. And what you can show is you can take, you know, this sequence, you know, all the way up to maybe the nth one, and you take off log of n. I'm taking the natural logarithm here, right? What you get if you look at this guy, so each stage you take off the log. Well, you know, 1 minus, if we take the first step, 1 minus log 1, well, that's just 1. 1 plus 1/2 minus log 2 is about 0.8. 1 plus 1/2 plus 1/3 minus log 3, that's about 0.7. If you carried on ad infinitum, you actually approach a finite number. It's called gamma, and it's the Euler-Mascheroni constant. This is about 0.577, which is if you take it square, it's about 1/3, okay? But not very much is known about this number. We know it exists. We can prove it exists. Basically, the proof relies on the fact that this sequence is decreasing. You can show also that it's bounded from below. Okay, so if it's decreasing and bounded from below, it's got to stop somewhere. So you can prove it exists, but we know hardly anything about it. We don't know if it's, say, transcendental. We don't even know if it's a rational number or not. It's kind of mad, right? We can describe it as a certain number of digits. Euler came up with about 15 digits. Mascheroni came up with 19. He then got the 20th, the 21st, and the 22nd one wrong. Nowadays, we know it's about 100 billion digits, but we don't even know if it's rational. If it is rational, we know that the denominator is greater than 10 to the 242,080. Denominator's got to be, that's if it's rational, but it might not even be rational. We don't know. Okay, so we know very little about it. And yet, this number, It appears all over everywhere, all over physics, for example. I know it from physics, right? When you calculate quantum corrections to say, I don't know, the mass of the electron or the mass of the Higgs, or you calculate quantum corrections to the charge of the electron, these sorts of things, this guy pops out. It always pops out. So it's there, it's in nature, it's in physics, and yet we don't know very much about it. It also, if you take e to the gamma, this knows about products of prime numbers, which is what's that got to do with anything? So it seems to know about stuff. There's a connection there. And actually, some physicists have actually sort of said that there might be something deep there, that ultimately cosmology is going to be very closely related to number theory. It's very speculative, this, but you know, in the future, maybe this is going to be a direction we go in.
If you're interested in numbers that govern the universe, you might just like this book called Just Six Numbers by Martin Rees. The famous astronomer shows how six numbers can explain the origins and behaviours of the entire universe. As an added bonus, the audiobook is narrated by Lord Rees himself. Now, Audible.com, which has supported this video, is a leading source of spoken material. They've got just a huge range of titles. Anything you can imagine can be downloaded onto the device of your choice. It doesn't matter what you're into. And if you sign on for a free 30-day trial membership, your first audiobook is included. So why not try Just Six Numbers? It's quite a short one, about 3.5 hours. If you enjoyed the video we just showed you, then I think this audiobook might be up your alley. Go to audible.com/numberphile when you visit them, so they'll know you came from here. That's audible.com/numberphile. Thanks to them for supporting this video.